অনেক মর্বিডিটি কমপ্লিট যা দ্যাট ইজ
डेफिनेटली First, a little bit discussion about pathophysiology of perioperative myocardial infarction. There is a increased risk of the plaque rupture and the thrombus formation due to surgical stress. The first, then insignificant coronary stenosis is there, hemodynamic stress or vasospasm or fibrinolytic activity, platelet activation or hypercoagulation. These are one of many pathophysiology which can happen during the perioperative period, which leads to acute myocardial infarction or sudden cardiac death. And sustained ischemia, it may be due to the myocardial oxygen supply or demand mismatch. There is some anesthetic agents are there, or there is some stress or physiological condition as there during the perioperative period, due to which there is an increased myocardial oxygen demand. But if there is a moderate stenosis or the coronary arteries are unable to comply with that increased oxygen demand, that may lead to myocardial ischemia.
Can you add Takotsubo here?
Sir, Takotsubo can be added, but Takotsubo during perioperative period, it is not that much significant. It is post-operative. Means we are able to find Takotsubo after the stress. Means after perioperative stress, the patient will
go well. The same stress which has led to this thing, right?
Definitely, sir. Takotsubo can also be. The stepwise approach. The first step is if surgery is urgent or urgently needed or not. We can discuss in upcoming slides. Now, if there is a need of urgent surgery, then whatever the cardiac complication, we have to comply with. Patient should go to surgery urgently. The definition for the emergency procedure is. The emergency procedure is one in which life or limb is threatened, and the time means there is no time or very limited time, basically less than 6 hours. Guideline says if the time to evaluate the patient is less than 6 hours, we can call it as an emergency surgery, and we should not further delay the surgery. Urgent procedure, the definition wise, time to evaluate the patient is 6 to 24 hours. We are allowed with 24 hours of the time, but not more than. We should not delay more than that. Then the next procedure is time sensitive procedure, in which we can delay up to 1 to 6 weeks. The surgical procedure can be delayed up to the 6 weeks, and during this time we can include some of the management, like if the patient is LVF, we can stabilize the patient, and after that we should proceed for surgery. Then the elective procedures. Elective procedures is which the procedure could be delayed up to 1 year. If patient is going for hip or knee replacement or any other elective procedure, cosmetic surgery, that procedures could be delayed up to 1 year. Now, if there is an urgent surgery, the surgery in which the life of the patient or the limb of the patient is at risk, we should proceed with the surgery with elevated risk. There is no need to further evaluation. Now, any active or unstable cardiac condition. If the patient has unstable angina pectoris or the acute heart failure or significant cardiac arrhythmia or symptomatic valvular heart disease with symptoms, symptomatic valvular heart disease, recent myocardial infarction or the residual myocardial ischemia. Recent myocardial infarction, most guidelines say consider less than 30 days, but to be on safer side, some guidelines consider up to the 60 days. So recent myocardial infarction in last 30 days and residual myocardial, if any of these things is there, better to postpone the procedure, and treatment option should be discussed with the primary surgical or and the cardiac. So better to address the cardiac problem first or better to address surgical, that should be discussed thoroughly. The examples of the unstable coronary syndromes is unstable or the severe angina class 3 or 4 or recent myocardial infarction, we have discussed last 30 days. Decompensated heart failure, if heart failure up to grade 3 or grade 4, grade 1, grade 2 is not a contraindication for emergency surgery. But heart failure, if grade 3 or grade 4, the significant arrhythmia, here high grade AV block, grade 2 or means Mobis type 2 or the grade 3 AV block. Then symptomatic ventricular arrhythmias, it may be either supraventricular arrhythmias including atrial fibrillation in which heart rate is more than 100 and symptomatic bradycardia or newly recognized ventricular tachycardia. Then severe valvular disease in which severe aortic stenosis or symptomatic mitral stenosis. Step 3. In step 3, we are discussing about the risk of the surgical procedure. There are some surgeries which carries low risk. Low risk is less than 1% risk of perioperative mortality due to cardiovascular injury. So, if it is a superficial surgery or brace, dental, endocrine or any reconstructive surgery or minor gynecological surgery or minor orthopedic surgery. In this, there is a perioperative mortality risk or the acute cardiovascular event risk is less than 1%. Intermediate risk surgeries, there is a mild elevated risk, 1 to 5% of perioperative mortality in which there is a hernia, the endovascular aneurysm repair, peripheral arterial angioplasty, then head and neck surgery, neurological or orthopedic major surgery, hip and spine surgery, then neurological or any gynecological major renal transplant and intrathoracic. That is a high risk surgery in which aortic or the major vascular surgery. Then open lower rib revascularization or amputation surgery. Then duodenopancreatic and any abdominal surgery, liver resection, duodenopancreatic or esophagectomy. Then repair of any perforated wall, adrenal resection, total cystectomy, liver endarterectomy. These are the high risk surgery. Now,
so that hernia was hiatal hernia, not anterior hernia.
No, yes sir, it is a hiatal hernia. Means any abdominal surgery is always carries.
Yes. Inguinal hernia, superficial hernia.
No, it is superficial. It is low risk surgery. The risk of the surgical procedure, if it is a low risk surgical procedure, that carries a less than 1% of the surgical perioperative with cardiovascular event risk. In this patient, other history or other cardiological significant risk factor should be evaluated, like if the patient is known case of the ischemic heart disease or patient has history of the MI, not recent MI, but history of MI 1 to 2, then we should start beta blocker regimen and patient can proceed for further, no further evaluation is needed in case of minor surgery. Then if the patient has heart failure grade 1 or 2 or the systolic dysfunction, then AC inhibitor should be added and patient can proceed for surgery. Then if the patient is undergoing vascular surgery, the statin is specifically needed or statin should be added if patient is not taking any statin. If is he undergoing the any vascular surgery. Then for intermediate or high risk surgical procedure, the step 4 is there. In step 4, we are evaluating the patient's exercise capacity.
That yes. Statin was in patient without known case of IFDS, sir. Any vascular
surgery? Yes, sir. For vascular surgery only.
Okay, whether baseline pressure is IFD, no IFD, that doesn't matter.
So step 4, in which the functional capacity of the patient could be assessed. This could be assessed by evaluating or there is no need to go to DMD or DSC. We are just asking the simple question for the daily routine. If patient is able to take care of yourself, eat, dress, use toilet, he is able to do routine activity, his functional capacity will be up to 4 mats. But if patient is doing daily jogging or go with some exercise, moderate amount of exercise, and he is or daily walk with brisk walk, if he is able to do brisk walk 10 to 15 minutes, if he is able to do swimming or if he is able to do lifting a weight, then his capacity should be considered greater than 10 mats. Now, if there is a more than 4 mats, his capacity is more than 4 mats, for intermediate or high risk surgery. For low risk, no need to consider max, but if intermediate or high risk surgery, if the patient's capacity is able to do more than 4 max activity, patient can be given clearance for going the surgery with the same treatment regimen like highest beta blocker in ISD patient than ACE for heart failure or systolic dysfunction, and if vascular surgery, statin therapy. Here, the class of indication is class 2B for one, and same with, there is a class 2B for beta blocker. So, it is recommended, means it is as per the risk benefit ratio, the benefit to going surgery is more than the risk of getting any cardiovascular event. Moderate or poor activity, for that we are going to step 5. If the patient's exercise capacity or the functional capacity is less than 4 max, for intermediate risk surgery, patient with one or more clinical risk factors. Here is the risk factors. The first, ischemic heart disease, angina pectoris or the previous myocardial infarction more than 30 days. Then heart failure grade 1 or grade 2. Stroke or transient ischemic attack, previous history of stroke or transient ischemic attack, then renal dysfunction in which the creatinine should baseline creatinine is more than 2 mg per dl or creatinine clearance less than 60, or diabetes mellitus requiring insulin therapy. If any of these risk factor is there with intermediate risk surgery, patient should consider any non-invasive testing. The non-invasive testing would be routine ECG, ECHO. Then the patient with one or more clinical risk factor, baseline ECG is recommended. So if there is a IHD or if there is a heart failure, the baseline ECG should be recorded. The reason for this recording baseline ECG, because this patient require intensive hemodynamic monitoring in the post-operative period. If you have a baseline ECG, you can compare with later, means if there is any acute ECG changes or if there is a acute hemodynamic changes, that can be compared. The cardiac risk factors in the high risk surgery, it is the same. The number of risk factors less than 2, rest, on rest echocardiography and biomarkers for evaluation of the LV function should be considered. So, on rest, echocardiography for LVEF and biomarkers like proBNP for evaluating the if there is ongoing heart failure or not. If number of risk factor more than 3, then the patient should go for cardiac stress test, and cardiac stress test BSE is preferred, as we have discussed. This patient has exercise functional capacity less than 4 max. So TMT is not viable option here. So DSE is preferred for cardiac trace testing. Then if trace rate consider extensive ischemia, if there is an extensive ischemia, individualized preoperative, either means cardiac intervention should be done or not, that should be discussed. Preferred is do cardiac intervention first if we can delay the surgery. Then no or more moderate stress induced ischemia, patient can proceed for the surgery. Extensive ischemia, if we are preferring the coronary procedure or the cardiac procedure for which there is a specific timeline, if we are not putting any stent, we are just simply do balloon angioplasty, there is no stent in that in procedure, patient can be go to surgery within or after 2 weeks of the intervention with aspirin continuation. Second thing, if we are putting the bare metal stent, surgery can be performed after 4 weeks but with a dual antiplatelet therapy for minimum 4. Then if we are putting the new generation desk, the surgery could be done after the 6 months, not less than 6 months, and DAPT should not be discontinued up to 6 months, minimum is 6 months. We can further extend as per the patient profile, but minimum is 6 months. And same with the old generation in which the surgery must be delayed for 1 year. CABG, if preferred option is CABG if we consider, and after CABG aspirin should be continued during the surgical or the perioperative period. beta blocker decreased the significant in 30-day mortality. So they decreased the any ischemic event or the any acute cardiac event in post-operative failure for the first 30 days. Then perioperative beta blocker used. The indication is perioperative continuation of the beta blocker in patient already taking, that is a class 1 and the level of evidence is B, that is a class 1 indication. Beta blocker should be always continued. Then perioperative initiation of beta blockers if patient has more than 2 clinical risk. Third is perioperative initiation of beta blocker if risk is only one of this factor, but that risk factor is history of IST. So perioperative beta blocker should be given. And bisoprolol or the atenolol is the first choice to start the perioperative beta blocker. Then high dose beta blocker is not recommended without titration. So during intra-op or during the perioperative period, high dose beta blocker is not recommended. The dose should be titrated enough. The preoperative initiation of beta blocker is not recommended to patient scheduled for the low risk surgery. So beta blocker is, if there is low, less than 1% risk surgery, the preoperative initiation beta is not recommended.
So preoperatively, at least how many days patient should be on beta blocker while you are considering?
Sir, mainly we are targeting, we are titrating heart rate. The resting heart rate should be 60 to 70 to get a good beta blocker response. Or exercise heart rate should not be more than 100 or stress induced heart rate.
Low dose it may take up to 2-3 weeks.
That's why sir, we have to start with the moderate dose. If the cordis we are starting 2.5 milligram, it's the bisoprolol 2.5 twice a day and increase or decrease according as per the rate response. The perioperative statin use, the perioperative continuation of statin is recommended. And if patient is going with the vascular surgery, at least 2 weeks before the surgery, statin should be introduced. Then, ESA recommendation on the perioperative aspirin use, continuation of the aspirin in the patient previously treated with aspirin may be considered in the perioperative period based on the risk of the bleeding and thrombosis. Then discontinuation of the aspirin in previously treated with that drug should be considered with hemostasis anticipated to be difficult. So if there is a neurosurgical procedure, if there is a procedure in which there are high chances of the bleeding or the bleeding is, there are high risk of the mortality due to bleeding, in this that patient only we can discontinue the aspirin. Now, the prophylactic coronary revascularization in stable cardiac patient. If performance of myocardial revascularization is recommended according to applicable guidelines for management of the stable coronary. If patient is going in the elective cardiac surgery and there is a significant risk, we can perform coronary revascularization in stable cardiac patient. If going to elective cardiac surgery, but if there is a low risk surgery, no need to perform this elective coronary revascularization. And the late revascularization after successful non-cardiac surgery should always be done. Then prophylactic myocardial revascularization before high risk surgery may be considered depending on the extent of stress induced perfusion defect. There are little bit controversy here in this statement. There are some guidelines which are saying while doing the DSE, we are doing the DSE or the stress echocardiography. If more than one coronary artery territory is hypoperfused or we are getting significant RWM in more than one coronary artery territory, then we must definitely go with angioplasty or the revascularization therapy before going for elective surgery. But if there is a single territory or the single artery is damaged, or you are getting ECG, means ECG changes and echo changes, both are pertaining towards the single artery, single coronary territory, we can leave it with the optimal medical therapy, beta blocker and the nitrates and everything, and we can do after the surgery. The routine prophylactic myocardial revascularization before
so low and stress in this perfusion defect is just routine stress echocardiography or you do thallium scanning?
Sir, thallium scanning is always indicated. It is better informative than routine echo. But if William Stead is not available, then definitely echo DSE must be done. The routine prophylactic revascularization before low and intermediate risk surgery, prone ISD, not recommended. For low and intermediate risk surgery, proven ISD, we are not going with the revascularization therapy for lower intermediate risk surgeries. Here is the table which summarizes everything which we have already discussed. In this table, we are saying the investigation. If there is an urgent surgery, the indication for echo, ECG and the stress is class 3C. It is harmful. Before doing any, you should not go with the ECG echo and that procedure for any urgent surgery. Then elective surgery, ECG echo must be done. It is class 1 C indication. Then for elective surgery, if the patient is stable and the surgery is the low risk, the third one. Patient is stable and the low risk surgery is there, no need to go with non-invasive testing, ECG, echo or the stress testing. But if the patient has clinical risk factor more than one, if there is a no clinical risk, we don't need to give any non-invasive testing. But if there is a clinical risk factor more than one, the baseline ECG must be taken. It is class 2B C indication. Then if there is an elective surgery in patient, stable patient with intermediate or high risk surgery is there and the functional capacity is good, no need to perform any invasive testing, patient can proceed for surgery if functional capacity is good, more than 4 max. Then elective surgery, stable patient, intermediate risk surgery and functional capacity is poor, less than 4 max, then number of risk factors should be considered. If there is no risk factor, baseline ECG must be taken and patient can go with the surgery. But if there is a more than one risk factor, the ECG must be taken and patient can proceed for surgery. But here, the stress test, it is class 2B indication, stress test must be done before surgery. Then, elective surgery, stable patient with high risk surgery or and poor functional capacity with more than one, means either one or two risk factor, in which ECG, echo, DSE, everything must be done, means stress test must be done. BNP and beta blocker should be started, BNP with all the routine protocols must be followed. And if more than three, means more than three risk factor, here the change is doing the stress test. For previous 1 to 2 risk factor, the indication of the stress test was 2B and the indication of the stress test changed to 1, stress 1. So with more than 2 risk factors, if 3 or 4 risk factor is there and patient is undergoing a high risk surgery, stress test is must. Here is the same thing in which we are going with chart. The patient treated with the percutaneous angioplasty and undergoing elective non-cardiac surgery, if we have done BMS, bare metal stent is there, then the 30 days, if we are going for operation in less than 30 days, it is class 3 indication, it will harm the patient, so must be delayed up to the 30 days. And after 30 days, we can proceed with the surgery. For DAS and with DAPT, with drug, we have put in the drug eluting stent and we are giving the dual antiplatelets. It is for less than 3 months, it is class 3 indication, don't do any surgery up to 3 months. This includes low risk and high risk everything. But up to 3 to 6 months, we should be weighted surgical risk with the cardiovascular risk. If surgery is more beneficial, we can proceed with caution in for 3 to 6 months of the period. Ideal period would be after 6 months in case of the new generation DAS and after 1 year in case of the old generation DAS. Non-cardiac surgery in case of the valvular heart disease. there is an indication of the echocardiography if there is a no prior report cardiography in last 1 year, and second, if the significant change in the clinical status or the physical examination, then we must go with the echocardiography first. After that, the surgery should be decided. Now, for adults who meet standard indication for valvular intervention on the basis of the echo criteria and symptoms and severity criteria, the valvular intervention before the elective non-cardiac surgery is effective in the reducing perioperative risk. If the patient has the severe aortic stenosis as per the echo, and the patient is severe symptomatic due to severe mitral stenosis and the symptomatic patient, these are the specific criteria to operate in valvular heart surgery. So valve operation or the valvular intervention should be considered before going any high risk elective surgery. Then non-cardiac surgery in pulmonary vascular disease, the class 1 indication is chronic pulmonary vascular targeted therapy. So therapy to reduce the pulmonary vascular pressure should be continued unless contraindicated and not tolerated. Second thing, unless the risk of the delay outweigh the potential benefit, the preoperative evaluation of the pulmonary hypertension specialist and therapy as per the pulmonary hypertension should be done before going with the surgery. Now, recommendation of the supraventricular arrhythmias. Ventricular rate control is recommended in patient with AF without any hemodynamic stability. If patient is stable, there is no failure, but still ventricular rate control, probably less than 100, should be controlled before going to surgery. The continuation of the oral antiarrhythmic drugs before surgery is always recommended. The electric cardioversion, when hemodynamic instability, if the patient is not stable hemodynamically, then electric cardioversion is recommended before the surgery. The vagal maneuvers and antiarrhythmic therapy for termination of the SVT is recommended. Recommendation on the implantable device if the patient has implanted PPM, ICD. So, interrogation of the any implantable device must be done preoperatively and the postoperatively. Then it is recommended that the person who is responsible for the programming and managing the device, that must be he or she must be present during the surgery. The recommendation on the ECG. The preoperative ECG is recommended for patient who have risk factor and scheduled for high and intermediate or high risk surgery. Then ECG who have risk factor and scheduled for low risk surgery, it is class 2A indication. The previous was class 1 indication. The preoperative ECG must be considered in patient who have no risk factor and intermediate risk. It is not indicated for the low risk. Preoperative ECG is not recommended who has no risk and scheduled for the low risk surgery. Rest echocardiographic LV assessment should be considered in patient undergoing high risk surgery, and asymptomatic it is not needed. Stress testing is recommended in high risk with more than 3 clinical factors. Then stress testing must be considered in high risk with less than 2 clinical factors, it is class 2B indication, and may be considered in intermediate risk, not recommended in any low risk surgery. Then preoperative angiography, if there is any acute condition, STMI, NSTMI, or angina not controlled with the medical therapy, in that patient, angiography is class 1 indication. Then may be considered, it is class 2B in chronic stable patient undergoing high risk. It is not considered in low or intermediate risk. Now, we are discussing some of the cases in which what should be done. The first is the 45-year-old male with road traffic accident, the crush injury in both lower limbs, no history of the hypertension, diabetes, IHD, history of occasional chest pain, and no case of the moderate mitral stenosis, medically managed. There is no breathlessness or NYHA grade 1, you can say. So, in this patient, better to, as per guidelines, patient direct or going for urgent surgery. No need to do further evaluation ECG. Okay. For case 2, a 65-year-old female planned for the cataract surgery, which is the low risk surgery, and history of diabetes, hypertension, complaining the intermittent chest pain. That's why we have gone with the ECG showing aesthetic changes suggestive of myocardial ischemia. In this patient, low risk surgery with active cardiac surgery, postpone the surgery and do cardiac intervention. The less preferable option, surgery with optimal medical treatment. That is, the both option is there. The first one is class 2A and the second one is 2B. For case 3, there is a 60-year-old male planned for any hernia repair. Here we considering the hiatus hernia repair. Then history of diabetic hypertension, ischemic, I mean central wall MI, history of PTCA before 6 months. Patient is able to daily walking for 30 minutes without any complaints, viewing for 15 to 20 minutes. Here the meds or functional activity patient is more than 4 meds. In this patient, intermittent surgery with no active complaints, with good functional capacity, proceed to surgery with risk and confirm beta blocker or ACE as per the guideline. ACE as per the EF. Case 4, the 55-year-old female planned for the bariatric surgery, which is high risk surgery and elective surgery. The diabetes, hypertension, ISD, status post PTCA before 4 years. There is no active complaint, in which the stress is DSC or thallium stain, and proceed as per result. If negative, the patient can go to the surgery. If positive, cardiac intervention and postpone the surgery. The case 5th, the 55-year-old female planned for the hysterectomy, gynecological procedure, history of diabetes, hypertension, history of CHD, status post PPM, DDTM. There is no active complaints. Proceed to surgery after baseline ECG and device interrogation, and keep PPM to standard. So that's all for today. Thank you.
The guidelines you saw, was it ACC or ESC?
ESC. Sir, ACC guidelines, there is a 2014. I have shown ESC plus combination of ACC.
ESC which year?
2014. There was recent update in 2020, but there is no much major update there was.
So you have included those updates?
Yes.
See, the point is,
yes, sir,
you should have a holistic approach.
Yes, sir.
Right? You can deviate from the guideline. See, my first sentence was, if the person is having CKD,
definitely
parameters will change.
Definitely.
He is having a bad liver. Because then your selection of anesthetic agents and other things,
everything will change.
Everything, all kinetics will be changed.
Yes.
Suppose he is having a sleep apnea with a severe obesity. Then probably you have to see the sleep apnea itself. There are no guidelines here.
So there is so much lacuna in the guidelines, because in cases of the severe mitral condition, of the severe valvular condition, there are lacking of the guideline. And
I'm coming to it, biggest risk factor is the patient himself.
Yes, sir.
Right? If he is having deconditioned body, this itself is the risk factor. Right? He is diabetic but active, and having a deconditioned body, the risk increases like anything as such. Because your post-operative recovery and physiotherapy and those things will create a problem in deconditioned bodies. So see the holistic rather than
specific cardiac. Yes, sir.
Thank you. It was a good one.